our CRA meeting, we're going to open with a prayer. Mr. Witzel?
Thank you. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for the opportunity to come here. We pray, Heavenly Father, that your wisdom and your blessings would flow out upon this board, that as they deliberate the issues of the day, that they would be granted great insight and wisdom. We pray, Heavenly Father, for every employee of the city and for the gift of public service. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the freedoms we enjoy and praise you for this city and community. And we ask all these blessings in your precious and holy name, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, Mr. Whitson, would you call the meeting, call the roll, please?
Yes, sir. Commissioner Nichols?
Here.
Commissioner Rader?
Here.
Commissioner Cady?
Here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Chairman Brudnicki?
Here. We have the, any additions or changes?
Yes, sir. The item 7C, the manager's office has requested that I pull that item from the agenda at this time.
Well, can we, we'll talk about it.
Okay.
We're going to leave it on there.
Okay.
We'll talk about it.
That's the only change.
Which one? I didn't hear you.
7C, I'm sorry.
People involved with 7C are here, so we're going to, address.
C, I'm sorry, as in cat, sorry.
7C.
We have the minutes from January the 4th.
Apologize.
7B.
B, 7B, not C.
Well, get it straight.
Yes, sir.
My fault, totally.
7B.
Well, we're going to address it.
Yeah, I'd like to discuss.
We're not going to pull it.
Okay.
We have the minutes from the January 14th meeting. Y'all had a chance to read those, or any questions about those, anything that you noticed that needed to be changed or added? If not, need a motion to approve?
So may I make the motion?
Your second?
Second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Brudnicki?
Yes. Any old business?
Not to my knowledge, sir.
Okay, we have two items on the consent agenda. Do we need to address either one of those separately?
Yeah, I'd like to pull off A, please.
Okay.
Separate them all then.
All right, well then we'll, okay, so do I hear a motion on B, 514 Maple Avenue House Demolition Grant?
So may I make that motion?
Your second?
Second.
Discussion?
If ever there was a poster child for house demolition, I drove by there.
What?
I was scared to be in the road.
Where is this at?
514 Maple.
Okay.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Brudnicki?
Yes. Okay.
And I just had.
Mr. Nichols, you had a question about?
Yeah, I just had a question on the Kings Avenue project. Has all payments to those people in the CRA been paid? Can somebody address that question for me? The ones that had some payments developed due from the contractor?
The actual payment of the invoices?
Yes.
We are waiting for your action before we finalize the payment on the bill.
Okay, there were several from the contractor that had to be paid, and there was one from the CRA?
Yes, the.
You're talking about money coming back to us?
To a couple of business owners.
Yeah.
Mike, Engineering Department. There's a couple of payments the contractor agreed to make, damage claims is what they were. We haven't seen anything on that. We can hold his final check. The final check hasn't been paid yet either to the contractor, so we can get some verification, even check with the homeowners.
And if we approve this, y'all could verify that those have been paid?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, that needs to be done.
Okay. I move approval of item A, final payment for Jinx Avenue project.
Second the motion.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Brudnicki?
Yes. Okay, we have a code enforcement presentation.
Yes, sir. Some time ago, this board authorized us to plan in our budget
improved tools for code enforcement. And we've been very, very pleased with the effort, the partnership with the police department. We meet together with them every few weeks. We talk about cases. We try to work collaboratively together. And the increased technology, I believe, has benefited their work and benefited ours. So I thought since we made this public investment with funds provided by the board, that we should have a brief presentation to share what's happening out there and give you a feel for what's going on. And I'm going to turn it over to them to kind of highlight that for you.
Good morning.
Morning.
I've got some handouts that will go along with.
Good. Go ahead, hand them out, yeah.
Sir.
Thank you, buddy.
Do you have an extra?
I've got enough.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you.
In early 2012, code enforcement began researching a program that would enhance the services provided by code enforcement to the citizens of Panama City. ComCate software was chosen along with additional hardware to be placed into the code enforcement vehicles. Thank you to the CRA. Thanks to CRA funding, implementation was able to begin by October 2012. ComCate is a web-based program designed specifically for code enforcement reporting and records management that is used by agencies across the United States. The ComCate program is password protected, which allows authorized users to access any report for any specific location.
Including commissioners if they so wanted to use.
Including, yes, sir. Benefits include the ability to access databases, create reports, and standard forms that are used on a daily basis. Officers can then print these reports and forms on scene instead of having to go back to the office. The stop work order depicted above is just one example of a document that is generated on scene. ComCate has also given us the ability to manage statistics. Previously, this was done manually, so this has ensured accuracy. This graph depicts statistics for 2013, which totals all cases, number of cases closed and still open, as well as a breakdown of any violation type.
Wow, that's a lot of cases.
Yes, sir, and that's just that is just unfit, unsafe structures.
Goodness
within the last six
gracious
months. ComCate can also map areas by location. Violation and frequency of complaints, for example, the pins in this map, represent unfit, unsafe structure cases in their locations just within the last 6 months. Again, this is just a brief overview of some of the key benefits of ComCate and how it has assisted code enforcement. Thank you again to the CRA for the funding for this program and the associated hardware. Together, we are able to become more efficient in the redevelopment of all these blighted areas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good.
Chief, I'd just like to add, just, you know, when we looked at this and we looked at this program, you know, about the efficiency, when she's talking about they have the ability to print those things in the car now, every time they would have to take any action, they'd go out, they'd look at the property, they'd take pictures, stuff, they'd have to come back to the office, they'd have to do all the research at the office, so they were losing time. So the amount of cases they were able to get to as far as code enforcement complaints we received was hindered by that ability. So now they come in the morning, they get their cases together, they go out in the field, and they spend most of their day in the field in their own site. They can pull up all the records with a property appraiser and everything right there on site, do everything much more readily. So, you know, it's improved their ability. There's three code enforcement officers and a manager who also works cases. So when you see 2,000 cases,
they're understaffed.
Yeah, there's four people doing that. So, I mean, that's a very, very heavy caseload. So just to kind of put that in perspective, and that's up from what they were able to do before. So just wanted to bring that to your attention.
Thank you, Chief.
I just had one question. If you got, C. James is practically, you know, he's got twice as many cases as the other two put together. Does he do different types? Or?
Well, that was
she.
That was she.
She.
Cecilia James. So she.
You answered my question.
There you go. I was just saying. Enough said, right?
No, I'm just teasing. I'm just wondering. Okay.
You make her do all that work, huh?
You want a little bacon? You want a little bacon?
Again,
egg?
We're
we're very proud of our relationship with the code enforcement group. They're very hardworking, really, you know, trying to improve the city, trying to improve the appearances. The data is available for you. If we can ever assist you in any way, we're trying to give them good and better tools to get the job done. So we just thought we would highlight this for you and as an example of a great partnership we've been able to work on.
Good job. Other questions? All right.
Tough job.
All right. B, we were going to pull this, but why were we going to pull this?
Several.
Go ahead. Because that some of the information had not been provided to the staff, and the taxes hadn't been paid yet, and some other technical issues when we talked about it with staff yesterday in the management meeting. So those were some issues that kind of came up at the last minute. And
okay. What taxes for which year?
The current year, but as I pointed out in the documentation here, they're actually not due until April Fool's Day.
Well, there's some people that just don't pay their taxes till the 1st of April.
Right,
so,
and
we can't use that. So there is other issues, though, that need to get resolved?
Yes, and the applicant was made aware of those, and it's my understanding that that information is forthcoming, and we had provided for that in the staff recommendation, because it is not our intent to give anyone a grant until every T is crossed and every I is dotted. There would be, from my perspective, several conditions that would need to be placed on the grant subject to award. I mean, it just, you know, okay. There were some things that needed to be completed, so.
All right. Yes, sir.
Jason Oaks, I'm with the Buccaneer, 711 Beach Drive. Yes, I got the phone call last night at about 4:30 saying it was being pulled. I was a little surprised because based on the recommendation from the staff, we don't ever pay the taxes, by the way, until spring break. We've been doing that for 15 years. And as far as the elevation is concerned, Mr. Whitson and I talked about that. I had our architect try to develop an elevation that tied into the three-phase approach in which we're after. One was the sign, two was the roof, and then three was the facade. They spent all weekend trying to get it prepared, and then I got the phone call. I do have a basic rendering that we were going to prepare, but we were told it was being pulled. But the actual elevation for presentation is available, just like we discussed. And we thought it would be conditioned on all those three things or things that you provided. We're good with all those conditions. We don't want anything to happen unless the T's are crossed and the I's are dotted. So.
And just one last clarification, the repairs that were being made to the roof were emergency repairs only. They were not the work because we cannot authorize a grant. You can't start work on something before it's you know approved.
That's correct. The roof needed to, we had actually made application for the January CRA meeting, but because one of my partners it was actually the low bidder, the CRA staff required us to go back out and get two more bids. That was five bids we had to get. Mr. Hobbs is still the low bidder. And then during that 30-day period with spring coming and with almost 12 rooms being down, we needed to make the emergency repairs to protect the property, collect the revenue, increase the ad valorem tax, et cetera, et cetera. So we were just trying to move this thing forward. We didn't realize it was going to be an issue with him bidding on the project. He, you know, he's got all the qualifications, all the other ones, but we were required to go get two additional bids, which we did do.
Okay.
So that we'd have started the roof with the funds and everything in January, but again, we were led to believe we needed two additional bids.
All right.
So do you feel comfortable, William, if we were to consider this with those, that it wouldn't be awarded unless those, if we voted to award it, that it wouldn't be awarded until those things are met?
Yes, that would be my recommendation, but again, if there are questions or concerns, you know, we want to make sure that we address, you know, all of those.
Understood.
The issue is, if you remember last year where we had a property owner that was an application presented, taxes were not paid, media got a hold of it, that was on the front page of the paper, and that was not good for that business. It was not good for this commission.
But those were past due.
They were paying them. He was aware of that. The The staff is aware that those past due, and he was going to pay that as well. But prior to that, it didn't come to light. And so my thought is I didn't even have an application with this about what's being applied, what T's have been crossed, what T's have not been crossed on this thing. Two, taxes were not paid. And if we're going to apply these grants, then we need to follow the rules identically for every CRA and apply for it. And when they pay their taxes and everything's crossed, then we write that grant.
But I think the other one, the taxes were delinquent.
From the previous year.
And they were. And he knew that. And staff had talked to him about that. And he was paying those things. He just hadn't paid it before it got to us to do that.
Well,
and they were paid.
But in this particular case, the tax aren't delinquent.
They're not delinquent.
Well, they're not paid.
Well, they're not delinquent.
They're not due until April the 1st. There's a difference.
I have no application. I have no application in this package, grant application. I just have a memo saying what it's going to be, and so with a letter on it. And if we're going to do it the same consistently, then we need to do it consistently.
I agree with that. My concern is we only meet once a month, and we're marching quickly towards the season and stuff. So
I want to keep the rules the same. I don't want to adjust the rules per property or per location. We just need to make it consistently. Yes.
Okay. And I guess I'll say it again. The other situation that the taxes from the previous year weren't paid.
I have no application in this package to look at. I didn't get it last week to say what was crossed. Is there insurance on this thing? The normal applications, seriously, are not included in this package. And I asked that. Yeah, I asked that question yesterday. I have no application. So for whatever reason, there's no application. So if we're going to do it consistently, for us to vote on it, needs to be consistent.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. So, yes, the taxes, based on this, it was delinquent. Based on what it was saying here, it would be delinquent after April 1st. So, two thoughts. One is I have no application here to verify insurance, all the other things on the application. When we vote on, we get that application with the supporting materials. That's one. Two is... if you did it tentatively based on after April 1st, because again, is we can't give the grant until those things are paid anyways, I guess. I don't know. Y'all tell me. But there's no application here for us to review, so we need to keep that consistent on this project.
So can you just run down for us what you consider to be outstanding?
There were some elevations on the phase plan that we want to see as part of the improvements. We cannot give a grant, if the taxes aren't paid.
I understand.
And
they're not delinquent, though. There's a big difference.
Right. Yeah. And then basically, that he concurs that because we've already funded the first phase, this is second phase, that the third phase would have to be delayed until after October 1.
That's fine, and that works good for us because the whole idea is get the roof on, collect the revenue, pay the taxes,
sure,
put the new facade on, tie everything together, increase the property value, etc. I mean, we're prepared to do what it takes to make this thing happen. I don't understand the whole thing about insurance. Of course, we got insurance.
Yeah, but when you submit an application, they provide that to us as the CRA board for us to review to make sure those things are complete. And each package has that. It's not included in the submission.
I don't think it's his job to do that. So.
Yeah, but
it's his. It's not yours.
Yeah,
but
it's not your job.
He would ask you to do an application completion for verification insurance, property tax.
He's got all that.
Do we have it?
Yeah, we have
it. It just wasn't included in my package.
Okay, so
yes. So why am I being penalized?
Can we do that subject to Mr. Nichols reviewing that particular thing that didn't get in the packet?
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
Is the rest of the commission satisfied?
And no reimbursement will be made until the taxes.
Fair enough.
Or the current tax bill is.
And you have a mortgage on this property?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the bank's probably going to make sure that you have insurance.
We have to do it all.
It's current and then it's paid.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so subject to that, subject to the elevation situation, what is the other issue?
The other issue I have is that based on we just approved in the city commission meeting a 10-year zoning requirement for him to be able to use that same zoning for 10 years. This, based on what I was reading here, is based on a 7-year. If he tears it down or sells it within that period of time, he'll pay us back in 7 years. I think that should go concurrent with the the 10-year plan of the zoning, and it should be 10 years at the same time.
Okay.
And so instead of a 7-year payback, it'd be a 10-year payback provision.
Okay. And that would be reflected as a lien, a city lien against the property? I mean, that's what I would assume. If they sell it.
I don't want a lien against it.
No, if they sell it within the 10-year.
It would be a contract agreement where they would pay back.
They would pay us back if they sell the property.
It's an unsecured obligation.
Well, that's right.
That's my point.
That's correct. Okay.
But and not to cloud the issue, but not for this, but in the future, we talked about this for the Oak Avenue renovation that was done down there on a roof. I have no problem with these types of arrangements. I think they're good to say if they sell it. But the value of that roof 10 years from now is not the value of the roof today. I mean, it depreciates. Right. So we need to find a way in the future of correcting for that. Because if they do it on year 9, they shouldn't have to pay back.
And that's a good point. The way we structured the deal is that we were just going to take the cost of the reimbursement divided by 10, and every year it goes by, it goes down by a tenth.
Okay.
That was essentially what we agreed to.
Okay.
Yes. Who agreed to that?
I agreed to it, and Mike agreed to it.
It's what was discussed.
No, we discussed.
It was what was discussed.
It was floated. You guys are in charge of agreeing.
Okay. Yeah. So I was just wondering who you talked to.
Mr. Woodson.
Okay. All right, so we're going to, so the discussion
we just thought it made sense.
Is you're going to incrementally depreciate that amount of money down through the life of the 10 years?
Right. So if let's just say they sell it at year 5.
Correct.
It would be half that value.
Okay.
So there will be an agreement that whatever the amount is, that if the project is sold or developed within the next 10 years, that every year that amount would be reduced by one tenth, and it would be an unsecured obligation between the owner of the property
entity, yeah.
And the city. Yes. Okay.
That's essentially the issues.
I don't have any issues with this, but I just want to ask a question, and this has nothing to do with this issue. But we give these grants out 12 months out of the year, right?
Most of the time.
Well, I mean, it's on our agenda usually every time. And what I'm trying to find out is, and maybe I'm just not getting something here, when we do something back in July, taxes haven't been paid yet.
Well, we make sure that
they're
current whenever we make the award, that they are current.
Yeah, okay, from the past year.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's cool. But not the current year.
Makes sense. Okay.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
Mr. Oaks, this is not about you. This is about how we handle things.
Yeah.
No,
I understand.
What information that we provide, and make sure we're consistent on any grant that we do, if it's on a roof on Oak Avenue, or if it's your roof. How do we do it consistently? And in the past, it's not been consistently, so it's hard for me to figure out when I show up here what I'm voting on when I get here, because information that I've learned today is something that's not in my package.
I understand.
So it's hard for me to come to a conclusion when I got one focus on one item, and then I'm learning new stuff, which changes the way that I feel. So that's what I'm just, you know, I don't know if we need a workshop this stuff, or I know the residential grant program's doing well and moving forward, but for us, in terms of the commissioner, I'd like to make sure whatever process we do on these applications, it's consistent, and there's some checks and balances that we're going to follow.
And if I just a minor technical point on that, the commissioner's correct. We had done a summary of the grant for you in the package instead of putting, you know, the application in, and then sometimes we'll, you know, put the sheet in, and sometimes we won't. So I'm going to go back to putting the application in the package.
The application has always been, this is the first time I have not seen an application.
Well, sometimes we have just summaries.
We just have the summary. So, I mean, and if this is what the desire of the group is, we'll put the actual application in. We had tried to make the packages smaller.
Just paperclip it to that item, please.
Yeah. We had tried to make the packages smaller.
Applications.
And kind of getting caught between make it smaller and, you know, provide all the information. So that's what's happening.
Mr. Mayor, the
major issues that I wanted to address have been addressed by Mr. Nichols. And like I said, one of the things that I was concerned about is we just came through with a 10-year deal, and then this was a 7. And so right now is from this point on now, since we're making alterations into the paperwork, where do we go from here? Do we vote, or do we just wait?
Do you have any other questions for Mr. Oakes?
No.
Okay. Anybody?
That's a question to the board.
Okay, I guess, are you want to talk about this issue? Okay, well, let's hear everybody.
Jane Lindsay, 551 Harrison Avenue. I appreciate Commissioner Nichols' comments on being consistent. 10 years ago, we asked for a new roof. And I saw maybe 5 years ago, Mr. Whitson in a parking lot at Lowe's while my husband and I were buying 10 5-gallon buckets of Elastomeric to put on the roof. Mr. Whitson said to me, well, why don't you put in a grant for a new roof? And I said, that would be wonderful, but I can't pay $60,000 for a new roof. Well, what we did was ask Mr. Whitson then, well, what could we do about it? And he said, well, I'm sorry, I can't make any repairs for you. Our grant program does not make repairs. It only puts on a new roof. So I don't know what anyone else is doing. Granted, I want the Buccaneer to have a new roof as bad as I wanted a new roof. But in remaining consistent with the policy, I would like for everybody to be treated as everyone else is treated. I am now getting my new roof. It will take 6 days to get it on. They started yesterday after how many years of asking for this. I have everything is ruined on the third floor due to the rain coming in from the lack of the building owners, you know, wanting to do this. So it's been a struggle, but I think that Mr. Nichols' questions on consistency is really important for you all. Repairs is one thing, new roof is another. And this may be a new roof that he's asking for on one of his sections, I don't know. But it was very painful when Michael and I got up on our roof. I can't tell you how many times over the past 10 years and put layers of Elastomeric up there ourselves. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
Swift, Glenwood Work Partnership. Talking two things. The length of, we're talking about 7 years and 10 years. Well, it appears that this money is coming from the Downtown North. Well, Downtown North expires in 2023. So if we're running, you know, does this agreement run concomitant with the Downtown North? So if you go to 10 years, you're going to be beyond the funding for the Downtown North CRA. You know, it will be gone unless you extend it, unless the city extends the, does what they did with Downtown and do an extension on the CRA. So in considering the timing, you know, you need to take a look at the That's a good factor.
But I'll bet you that the board will be addressing that at least 2 or 3 years before it ends, and the chances are we'll probably get that thing extended.
And my understanding is that if there are any monies left in the CRA after they expire in the trust fund, they revert back to the tax.
Correct.
Back to the city.
Everything is goes back to the city. Zeroed out to back the to the contributing organization.
To the taxing authority.
Still come back.
To the taxing authority. Words of the legislation. Goes back to the taxing authority. Okay, number two, in looking at 56,300, it looks like there's $112,000 in that line item, and it looks like this is looking for $124,000. Where's the rest of the money coming from? Looking at that line.
They have to pay it.
Well, I'm saying the CRA's contribution.
Fortune is not
is $124,000.
There's funds there.
Okay, there's funds there, but in that line item, it's there's only $112,000 there. So we need, so we might have to do something on that. That's just a question. Okay.
Thank you, sir. All right, we'll go on to 7C.
Well, we have a vote.
Okay.
That was my question. Do we vote on it today?
Yes, we have a, all right, is there a motion that we proceed with the Buccaneer Roof Grant and that we get the information and application to Mr. Nichols and entrust him to look at that application and be satisfied with that application and to let Mr. Whitson know if he is, and until that time and that the elevations issue is dealt with, that we do not go ahead and disperse that.
So you'll be make that motion because I've had those changes to it.
I just, yeah.
Yeah,
I
mean that. So I'll move approval.
Okay.
Based on we taking it from 7 years to 10, I think they agreed upon that. Applying for that grant along with the changes. I mean, as long as the T's are crossed and I's are dotted, I mean, I think we just need to be consistent on this.
I appreciate what you're saying.
And with, okay, and with the depletion of the amount over the 10 years.
With the depletion, which is fair. I agree with that. Depletion over that 10-year period of time. And maybe y'all should request that we actually put that in writing, what that depletion is over that period of time, in some type of form letter for you. And provided that additional information to be completed, the T's crossed, I's dotted, and so I'll make a move based on those changes, approve the grant.
Second that motion.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Bernicke?
Yes. Okay, we get a report on the residential task force.
Hold on a second.
I'm sorry to
interrupt you. Yes, sir.
I didn't want to convolute that particular line item, but I did.
What's your name?
And who let you in here?
Please identify yourself, sir.
Is there going to be a cell tower?
I hope you weren't in church Sunday. Go ahead.
Wow, I'm in trouble.
I said a lost Sean McNeil. Did not see that.
I'm Sean McNeil, 1078 East Caroline Boulevard. I'll give you my personal address because I want to talk to you about, not as an engineer, but as a property owner downtown that I have interest in two properties. And I was interested in your comments about this 7-year payback period. And I don't know, and thank you once, because I've been a beneficiary of the grants, and it's helped us improve our properties. But I never have signed an agreement to pay you if I happen to sell the building. So if you want to apply consistency, if anyone gives a grant, they should be signing agreements with that. And I do think that will keep your coffers a little more full. And I assume you're doing a straight line depreciation over 7 years. That would be fine with us, or myself, with regard to my properties. But I think it should be applied for all grants, not just roofing. But I think you have parking improvements and painting improvements and exterior improvements and the whole nine yards. So I don't know if you're doing that. And so I'm just saying, if you want to be consistent, I think that would be consistent application.
That's a good point.
And not just the roofing repairs. And I would be also, I am concerned, obviously, about my roofs. They are old buildings. They are. I've been up in the attic many times with buckets, I assure you. But that's a lot of money when you look at all those rooftops downtown.
Yeah. That, just to address your point briefly, the reason this came up with this particular applicant was because they had openly discussed with us their plans to redevelop the property and put it up for sale and things like this. So it was a clear holding strategy. Where it was declared up front.
I am familiar with their redevelopment plans, yes, sir.
And we had discussed, so, we had
do I have to change my address now?
Yeah, and there have been some resistance to putting those. Burton, we were talking about demolition.
Right.
And, you know, the thing is, too, we got to be smart about the depreciation. I mean, the life of the roof isn't 7 years.
Right.
So it shouldn't zero out after 7 years if you have to reimburse it.
Right. Well, I don't know. Maybe
I don't know,
it should be a straight line.
A straight line, but I'm just saying it may be longer than that period of time. But those are all issues that need to be addressed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. We would assume that in the future, when something sells, it's going to be worth more?
Because of the new roof?
And no, but what I'm saying is that then the tax base will be reestablished and the property tax amount will be reestablished. And so
I'm not a property appraiser, but I think a property appraiser will tell you that repairs are not, don't go to value.
No, I understand.
And so I don't, you know, some guy getting $50,000 grant for improvements to their property doesn't necessarily going to, you know, gain that in the sale of their property. So paying back the CRA is really taking away from the value of that property in a way. Of course, he got it for free in a sense, but
point
good
taken.
Luck with
Thank
all
you.
That. Thank you. I appreciate your time.
See you Sunday. I hope. Okay.
You guys are going to the wrong church.
Residential Task Force report.
We got some good music.
Bringing forward the a report of the Residential Task Force to you for your consideration. We've been working on this for quite some time. As you know, we have the residential grant program, but there was a desire to take a look to see if there were other things that we could do to enhance the residential grant program and perhaps remove a few of the barriers to entry into this process, especially as it related to senior housing. And we did convene representatives from across all of the CRAs, and that group was joined by some technical experts from the Community Development Block Grant Program, the Council on Aging, Habitat for Humanity, and even a representative from Gulf Power to try to see what we could do in terms of partnership in building things together. Perhaps the CRA contributing seed funds to the effort. And we have developed the attached report. There's a chart that is the actual model, how the new housing partnership model that's being proposed. And then on that chart, there's an attachment that kind of drills down and explains some of the concepts that are included in each of the steps of the boxes. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about this quite a bit, and I'll be quite honest with the board. We don't know if this will work, but we also don't know that it won't work. And we don't know that we may have stumbled on to, because of the efforts and the desires and requests of this commission, a new and improved model and a better way of doing business. So our proposal is, let us give it a shot. Let us allocate some funds and let us go to work and see if we can find a case or two to run through the model where we can partner and leverage resources, bring people together for a common good. And we've had multiple people look at this. This is a very, very complex issue, just like the last one you talked about. I mean, there's just no right one magic silver bullet that's going to resolve all concerns. But we've given a really good effort. This is the report that was drafted up. I'm very proud of all the work that the staff has done on it. I know Commissioner Brown has been involved in it. Commissioner Katie's been helpful in the process. There's been, you know, multiple people help us with this. Really have to tip my hat to Michael Johnson at CBDG and some of the other people that have tried to assist us. So this is our report, our suggestion, and our recommendation. I wrote that up for you on the agenda action item, that it would be basically our suggestion that you allow us to initiate a pilot program and allocate up to $35,000 to test that program and see what we can do to walk away with a victory here. There's things that maybe our program didn't recognize going in, and there's a way of maybe tackling these issues out of the box. And as you know, that kind of excites me, and one of the things that our staff does best.
With all due respect,
I'm sorry. Question.
Go ahead. I don't care. You go ahead.
All right. Start with Nichols.
Yeah. Mr. Whitson, I want to commend you that developing the partnership and the people involved in that. That's a great team that do the exact same thing. So it's good to have partners in our community to work for the better, the better of housing for some of maybe our less fortunate or just that partnership. The question I have is, this $35,000 budget impact out of an $87,000, is that from the downtown north?
Yes.
From, okay. And so in terms of this residential grant program is just for the downtown north?
It would be the pilot, our suggestion to try it there first.
Okay.
And then if it works, then we can expand it to other areas as the group or commission so desires. Okay.
And you have the other CRA sitting in this
Everyone was involved in
involved.
Yes, sir.
And so they're learning as well so they can implement some of these programs in the other CRA as well.
Yes, sir, and it would be my suggestion and intent that as we go along that we would call the task force back from time to time and update them, and then I would put those reports in your packet just so that you can stay abreast of it, and then we would just kind of move along together.
And so that I guess the only other question I have is when I was looking at in terms of the budget here of $87,000, is that in that budget for residential improvements, or what is that? What's that 87 part of the budget of? Is it?
I believe it is, but I'm gonna call on Tony to give. She knows more of the particulars than I do.
Good morning. If memory serves correctly, the $87,000 in that particular line item has residential slash commercial. The downtown north has the luxury because of the funds to set funds aside for residential. You also note in that line item that there are other commercial grants. So those funds, it was my intent to use for residential. And there's one residential incentive assistance, and that's the residential improvement. I think that's the name of it.
Okay. And I don't want to regenerate the wheel. I'm just trying to figure out, you do have the largest budget.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you allocate a percentage of that budget towards residential improvements and a percentage towards commercial improvements, and then a certain percentage in terms of infrastructure. So I think $35,000 is a low number. And if there's, like you said, you went by that house, and if that was the model for tearing a home down, is there some other opportunities that more funding needs to be allocated towards residential task force?
My understanding is that the $35,000 is for the coordination function, right? It's not for the actual improvement.
It would be to gap fill. So we're going to say we get an applicant, and Gulf Power can contribute something, Habitat can contribute something, CBDG and, you know, Council on Aging. Yeah, and then say if there's something they don't cover, then that we could take funds out of the $35,000 to put in towards the project. And, of course, we'll need to facilitate the coordination and all that. So we'll be doing two functions, staff function and then helping to contribute where maybe another partner couldn't cover a piece.
But for the CRA contributed funds, you still have all the same requirements you had before, right? You
yes.
still have a clear deed, insurance,
yes,
matching, everything, right?
It would be all of the...
For the CRA portion.
All of the items in the model here.
Right. Because, you know, I was confused that... Because I thought you were looking at somebody to be an ombudsman for all the various agencies that could, so somebody would come in that was in the CRA downtown north and say, this is my problem, and that mm-hmm. person, and it was kind of bewildering because I thought that's what our community development department did already, citywide.
Yeah.
It would look at various sources, and I thought that's what the 35 was for. That was my question, too, was the money going to go to? Who are you going to have administer it?
That's part of my question, too.
It would, the funds were there to contribute to a project that the group would facilitate through this model.
Okay, so not for coordination.
Right.
Who's gonna do the coordination?
We will work with the groups identified here, and I think Council on Aging had said that they, you know, may have a staff volunteer that could assist us as well.
But as far as the overall coordinating agency, it'd be the CRA?
Basically, yes.
It would be you?
It would be, yes. It would be, it would be me, because at the last meeting, the group asked to identify maybe two additional homes that were like the worst case scenario. Right now we're working with the one home, and they see that as worst case scenario. So I've had an applicant to come in that is pretty close to the primary applicant that we have. But the it's my understanding that the $35,000 is gonna assist in the process. Now, the current residential improvement assistance incentive has a certain set of criteria. What we're about to approach is a subset of that because of the issues that the homes are presenting. So you're gonna keep the one that's current. Am I making?
We're gonna keep the existing grant program.
Exactly.
This is an additional.
And we will give them 50%.
Right. Yes.
This is
an extra.
Actual money that we are supplementing to these other organizations to get something accomplished.
Yeah. Right. To get something accomplished and or do more than the 50%, because what we're finding is that this population can't bring the 50%. So we said, well, let's do a pilot. If we do a pilot, then we step away from the original, okay, and we become a different type of response mode, if you would.
But I think what he was asking, I'm not putting words in Mike's mouth, but he was saying, did that $35,000 come out of the residential grant for the 50% program? Is that where you took that $35,000?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So I don't know if that's, if we should do that, if that shouldn't be additional money, that it's not in there. You know what I mean? I mean, we're pulling from something we would be.
It's an earmark, basically, is what it is.
Be a designated amount.
So is that what we want to do, or is that getting, because we're we're actually limiting the 50% grant program amount by doing that. But
that's
a pilot. I mean, we can always do a budget amendment.
And I think and you've done a good job identifying an area that is hard to work on via the 50% they could come up with, and so you partner with the different people in the community to really provide maybe 75% of that funding, mm-hmm. and we're doing the 25% and working together. So you identified that crack that everybody's falling through, so you identify that. So I commend you on that. So the next question then is 87,000 in terms of your overall budget, and this is probably the first year was the big budget, I guess, the big. So is there should be some percentage amount allocated to residential grants, and then out of the subset, you have this part where you could take a dollar and really stretch it out with your partners?
I think that's a good suggestion, and we will have the learning from this experience, because right now we don't know the impact of that $35,000. I mean, this thing could swell if we, depending on the home that we touch. So we're going to be really analytical about this. And
well, just even on the 87, I'm looking at the bigger picture, the 87,000.
Right.
Is there should be some 10%, 15% of your overall budget allocated to residential grant, maybe 15% or so allocated to commercial grants, and so much to infrastructure. Do y'all do it that way, or is it some other percentage calculation you'd use for?
We have not done percentages of allocations. What we've done is to really look at the funds we've received and really carry the same amount, because we haven't had a major impact, i.e., for an example, Buccaneer. This would be our largest expenditure. So we're now evolved in our grant process where we need to begin to sit down now as a set of policies, because what affects the North, ideally one would think would affect, I mean, my percentage may be larger because of the larger budget, but setting aside those funds in a percentage mode would probably assist all the CRAs.
Okay.
Because, you know, different things are happening but to the North, but the same thing is about to happen in Millville, because we have similar socioeconomic status kinds of situations.
Do you allocate the whole 87 usually for residential 50-50 matches?
Yes.
Do you have additional funds in your budget that you set aside additional $35,000? And not use part of the $87,000?
Yes, because when you look at the budgeting method for the city, it has a line item. Okay, within that line item, now what you see for the CRA budgets is that we bring in a lot of detail. But if you remember when we went through the budgeting process and there was a one-page document, that one-page document has those line items. You are effective as long as you utilize the dollars within that line item.
Okay.
Just to kind of add, Commissioner, we traditionally haven't used all of the residential grants in the north yet. I mean, we just haven't utilized all those resources yet.
So, Tony, you're going to be the ombudsman. And we're not paying anybody else to be an ombudsman, right?
No.
Or the CRA is going to be.
Tony and I are going to handle this.
Okay. Well, that's all right.
Tony has assistance.
That was one question I had.
Yeah, so the question was, could we just use another?
This was a trap. No, I'm joking.
So that's what I was going to ask is, should we use another $35,000 if that budget allows it to pull it out?
We can do a budget amendment if we need to later on.
But they don't have, what Tony was saying, they don't have to do a budget amendment. They can move funds within the line item.
Within the line item, yeah.
It's over $300,000.
So you could, okay, so you could keep the 87 and add the 35 instead of taking it from the 87.
I could take it from the.
Is that what you would need from us if that's what we felt is to, or, I mean, again, as you're asking for us to approve this using that 35, so would you ask us also to say, we'll keep the 87 but move 35 from somewhere else within inside that line?
Yeah, if we needed to do that later on, we could do that, yeah.
So would you want to do it today? I mean, could we do it today?
There's no need at this point. This is just kind of get it started.
Okay, so if you run out of funds in the residential grant 50-50 match, you could come back to us and say.
Well, what would happen is that I probably wouldn't run out of monies maybe in that line item because I have the, so you got to look at the, I don't have the line item number, but let's say it's 54,600, okay. And I have $300,000. And what we do is go in and almost show you like a small work plan, residential, commercial assistance, commercial development, okay? I have that $300,000 to work with, okay?
Would you use it for commercial or residential?
Yes, technically, okay. Yes.
Yes.
But we go in and let you know from a detailed standpoint what our forecast is, but I still have the overall $300,000.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, one thing I'm happy to see is this residential grant program is coming along. I made all of the meetings that I could. And one thing we've realized here that one size don't fit all, just like Mr. Whitson just said. And I'm happy to see the unity of the local governments coming together. But my understanding was, I don't know if I'm wrong, my understanding was the help will be coming from the other organizations, but the funding will be coming from the Downtown North CRA for that pilot program.
Or a combination thereof. They may have resources they want to contribute as well.
All right. So as long as they cover what they need to cover, and it'll be legal for them to do that without taking from their budget.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, good. All right. And I think it's working along pretty good, and I want to thank you for understanding what I was trying to say and what I was trying to get. But now this information that I received came from the citizens, and I was just trying to pass it on the best I could. And I want to give you outstanding ovation for what you've done. And I like to see it continues. And with the pilot program, I believe we're going to learn more, just like you say. And this may be a residential grant program that will go out throughout all of the CRAs and probably beyond, I think.
Any comments, Mr. Cady?
No.
I want one question. What does extra credit to senior citizen applicants? What is that extra credit?
It's basically that when we review two applications, that a preference would be given to seniors first as opposed to, say, a family.
And what's the age of what's the senior age?
65 or older. I mean, whatever the law. I mean, that's the CBDG rule.
Right, because in this, yes, yeah. In this process, we're using CBDG, Council on Aging, Habitat. So we're having to, there's a tier, if you will, the way the model is designed.
Okay. I didn't know what the age was, and I want to make sure that was.
Yeah, we would use the accepted criteria. Yes.
Okay. Anybody else got any other questions? Hear a motion that we approve this 7C?
Yes, I would like to make that motion.
Right. Hear a second?
Second.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Brunicki?
Yes, sir. Okay, we have budget amendments. Those are listed there. Nothing earth-shattering.
No, sir. We were
pretty close.
Pretty spot on with the with the budget forecast.
Do you have to approve these?
Yes.
You have a
It's actually, the motion would be to approve Resolution 2014-1.
Move approval.
Second motion.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Chairman Brunicki?
Yes. Resolution. Oh, you're going to read this, huh?
Yes, I do.
I forgot you were sitting there.
Resolution number 2014-1, a resolution providing for the amendment of the 2014 budget by district for the Panama City Community Redevelopment Agency for the fiscal year beginning October 1, 2013 and ending September 30, 2014.
And by the way, to go back, for all the people that participated in that residential grant task force, thank you so much, because that did take a lot of coordination. We appreciate it. Updates.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, you have in your packet updates from each of the CRA districts. As you can see, we've been extremely busy. And I would like to call your attention to the special blacks and wax program that's coming up. And there will be a special press event prior to that. That we would need Commissioner Brown and the mayor or your designee to help us with, and we'll get you that. When is that?
19th.
The 17th, but the press time. 17th in the afternoon.
Yeah. We'll make sure Sharon's got it on the. I think she's already put it on your calendar. Yeah.
And then one thing I'd like to do, Mr. Mayor, is. the board had to make a difficult decision with the marina redevelopment to take down the magnolia trees, and I hated that because they were so beautiful. But one of the things we did was we worked with the garden club to take clippings and seedlings from that tree before they were taken down. And I don't take any credit for this, but the ladies with their magic green thumbs have preserved one of the actual seedlings from that tree, and wanted to present it to you in honor of Arbor Day.
Nice.
And also I'm going to call Keith Baker up there and have you pass it to Keith, because this seedling will probably be returned to the marina someday or a park close by in honor of our promise to make sure that tree lived on.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Don't kill it. Don't kill it. Don't kill it, kid.
Don't let the cat near it.
Yeah. Don't over-fertilize it.
Your job depends on it.
That's right.
Yeah. Your job depends on that.
That tree did.
Anyway, any questions, be glad to entertain those.
Okay. All right, anything else?
I learned more about trees and bushes and limbs that day. You shake stick at.
Good for you. let's see. Back on the agenda here.
Yeah.
Public comment. Is there anything that was not discussed today that we needs to be discussed that's not on the agenda today?
Jane Lindsay again, 551 Harrison. I just want you all to know there are 6 new businesses downtown that are in the process of coming in. We have a new antique shop. We have a new Middle Eastern store, grocery store. We have a new dress shop coming in where Lee's consignment was. It's going to be Cindy's Closet or something to that respect. We have another one coming in where the gold and bullion gentleman was. It's going to be another sort of a shabby chic and antique shop. We also have the new Taylor Designs shop. I'm sorry, I don't know the whole name. It's a long name. But that's wonderful, in the old JCPenney's building. And we also have a new coffee shop coming downtown, I understand. So we're all really excited. We thank you for all you do. We thank you for the monies you put forth for all of this. And as the commissioners, the CRA, we just thank you for downtown. Now we want the new marina. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Me too. Okay, anything else come for us? Yes, sir.
Andrew Van with the Millville Community Alliance. I would just like for you guys to take a look at the fishing pier in Millville one more time, because there's some warranty issues and the warranty's running out. We're running out of time.
Yeah, that isn't that like the 1st of March?
April, I believe, is the deadline for that, and we're coordinating with Public Works to watch that and make sure that all of those repairs are on the punch list and coordinated through Public Works. So Mike and Neil are working with us and make sure we get that done.
We got that, Neil? All right.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? All right, we're adjourned. Thanks.